And now we're moving into game two. Right? And I'm going to start the game in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. All right. So, and yeah. La la la. Cool. What do you think about the next game? Do you think Meep Merc would change their strategy and just stop with the death ball lineup, or do you think they're gonna give it another go?
Well, it depends on what kind of team they are. Maybe they'll still go with the death ball. The death ball is still very powerful. You know, maybe they were undermined by their decision to actually go for kills earlier on instead of going for towers. If you notice, they had a huge kill score advantage compared to the Radiant. But, you know, that's actually because they were going for the kills instead of the towers, you know. So we can't go for kills all the time if you're not going for a late game lineup. Your objective is to take down towers and to take down a lane of racks as soon as possible to be able to choke your opponent. But if you're not going for that, and if your lineup is designed for that, then your lineup will fail in other areas later on. So right now, here is maybe a respect bat for the Invoker. They saw that the Invoker was very powerful in the hands of Tactica Gaming. So they wanted to ban that out first. Because Invoker is quite a versatile hero. If you have a good Invoker player, a good Invoker can be anything. You can make him a pusher, you can make him a ganker, you can turn him into a crowd control hero. Invoker is just so flexible to build. So in the hands of a good player that Team Meep Merp recognize, you should just take that away. Now they pick the Lycan. I think they're still going for a form of a pushing lineup. Now, but still, they're on the Radiant. Lycan has a natural advantage on the Dire because he can take down the Roche easily. And I think that the Dire has a better layout of their jungle. That's my opinion. Some people would disagree, but I think it's a generally agreed upon consensus that the Dire has a better layout of the jungle for junglers. So they pick up the Lycan on the Radiant side. Kind of unusual. The Jakiro comes as the first pick for Tactica Gaming. Now, maybe the Jakiro is a strategic pick for their Jakiro player earlier on. Did you notice who it was? Do you remember who played
Jakiro? Yeah, Jakiro was played by Nons, if I'm not mistaken.
It was by Nons. Well, it was a very good Jakiro. Very well-placed ice paths in team fights. You could even go as far as saying that the Jakiro won a lot of the team fights because of the well-placed ice paths followed by the Invoker's ice wall. But now they have the Jakiro and the Tidehunter. Now this is a massive, massive team fight capability. The Tidehunter Ravage can easily transition into an ice path paired with a macro pyre. That's a lot of damage going in the way of anyone caught in a team fight. So again, we see a team fight centric lineup for Tactica Gaming, and we'll see what Team Meep Merp has to say against that.
5 seconds. And what else? I think what's going to happen is I don't know, Coach, correct me if I'm wrong, but Lycan is still one of the heroes who would actually pick if you're going for a death ball, right?
Yeah, Lycan is a good death ball hero because he can farm creeps easily, he can get his Necronomicon up fast, he can actually take down towers fast because of his wolves and his howl ability, and even his necro creeps get a buff with his howl and his, yeah, even the feral impulse affects necro units, and pretty significantly the shapeshift also increases the move speed of his wolves and necro units to 5-2-2. So all his skills actually are quite synergetic with Necronomicon, which allows him to take down towers fast early on. But because he's building a Necronomicon, which is not really a carry item, his potential falls off towards the late mid or late game. But now they pick up Brewmaster. So Brewmaster is actually good in teamfights himself because he can get initiated on, and if he gets the split up before he dies, he can actually get a turnaround on whoever initiated on him. So we have mid Brewmaster, very popular mid hero right now. They're going for a ban. Maybe they'll ban some form of carry. A carry that can do well in team fights. Maybe a Spectre. Tinker, there we go. A Tinker is a carry. Don't get me wrong with this. I have to keep reiterating this. Tinker is a carry. Even if he's an int hero, he's not a right clicker hero. Tinker is a carry in the sense that he gets priority one farm. He's a one position hero. He gets farm and he is amplified. The items he gets are amplified by his skill set. Now that's the most important definition of what a carry is. You farm, and whatever items you build, it's amplified by your skill set. Now it's not going to be right click damage for Tinker. It's not even going to be survivability for Tinker. It's going to be damage in the form of Dagon and an Ethereal Blade, and possibly control in the form of a Sheep Stick. Now those are just items that do something, but in the hands of Tinker with the rearm, he can do a lot more with those items than any other hero holding those items. So that's what
it's going to be.
So definitely that's going why to be they banned Tinker. And then they banned the Centaur Warrunner, another great teamfight hero, because he can give an instant initiate for anyone in his team with a Stampede. And the enemy Tactica Gaming bans out Rubick, of course. They don't want the enemy getting their hands on Ravage. And they ban out Razor. I don't think they needed to ban out Razor here, because Razor is a mid hero typically. They already have a good mid hero in the form of Brewmaster. In fact, sometimes, a lot of the time, Razor is actually picked in counter to the Brewmaster. So maybe this is a bit of an unnecessary ban. But if they think that Team Meepmerp is going for a push-centric lineup, the Razor is actually a hero that can switch from ganking to right-clicking to a bit of a nuke, then later on to a very, very good pusher in the form of his Aghanim's ult. And maybe a refresher on top of that. So right now, we see the picks coming in. I think it's going to have to be a carry this time. They banned the Tinker, Centaur, Warrunner. Those are good supports and carry. But still, they have a lot of carries to choose from. Maybe they can go for... I'm preferential to Spectre in teamfight-centric lineup. But there are quite a few other carries that can benefit from a good teamfight as well. Something like a Sven. When you initiate with Ravage, if you get them in a position where they're clumped up against each other, the Sven could naturally just cleave his way through a bunch of opponents stunned together. A Luna, there you go. He's also Luna is also a good teamfight hero with the Moon Glaives, kind of like a cleave
TA
in a way, or a TA actually. So those are both heroes that do ranged attacks, but do somewhat of a cleaving effect by dealing attack damage Shadow to Shaman. More than one unit. And they pick up Shadow Shaman. They're definitely going for the death ball on this one. Meepmerp, they're sticking to their guns. They want to end this game as soon as possible, especially with Lycan Shadow Shaman. Maybe they've learned from their mistakes. And yeah, hopefully we'll see a very good game this time. So two just opposing strategies. Yeah. Go.
Just a thought. Do you think that they could have actually banned the Razor to give way for an unobstructed chasing mechanism? I don't know, for their carries. You know, they don't want their carries getting thrown out of position because of the static link. It was just a thought. Could it be that? That's why they banned it, even though the Brewmaster was already taking the mid.
Maybe, but if you look right here at their first few picks, we don't see much going in the way of right-click damage. Now, the Luna is a great right-clicker when she gets to the late game because of that Moonglaive that deals bouncing damage to heroes and creeps. But their primary damage sources would be the Lucid Beam, the Eclipse, Jakiro's spells. You know, those aren't really much of right-click abilities, so you can't shut them down with a right-click drain from Razor. maybe they were going, yeah, I still think they were going against the Death Ball lineup, but they forgot that the Shadow Shaman is still up in the pool. Maybe they're going to go for Death Prophet right now. Death Prophet is still up in the air. They can still pick the Death Prophet. If they really want to go all out on this,
yeah,
the Death Prophet would be their choice.
This is just dangerous for Tactica Gaming. They haven't actually seen the ban coming in.
But they get the Lina. Now, they can ban a carry or the Death Prophet. There we go.
They didn't want to take the chance anymore. They knew that it could be. It's a possible pick. So, yeah.
So, on the side of the Radiant, they'll want to ban... No, they already have a carry. So, they might want to ban another CC hero or a defensive hero, actually. Right now, I see Tactica Gaming benefiting from Omni Knight. Yeah, quite unusual. But because Brewmaster deals quite a lot of physical damage, the Lycan deals quite a lot of physical damage, and the Shadow Shaman wards, those are all physical damage. So with a well-timed Omni Knight ult, Guardian Angel, they can easily turn a team fight around even if the wards are placed. And the Repel can actually hold back spells casted by the Shadow Shaman and the Lina. So if you want to protect the target like the Luna, you just have to cast Repel on the Luna, and Luna can start wailing away at the enemy targets. So that's an unusual ban or pick. That's what I would pick if I were Tactica Gaming right now. But they ban out the Ancient Apparition. Yeah, they don't want the enemy to go maximum team fight on this. The Ancient Apparition is good against tanky heroes, because the ultimate threshold is actually a percentage of health, not a fixed number. So that helps, and it also cuts off regeneration. So if it manages to get to a point where they get a mechanism and maybe tanky items like a heart, the Ancient Apparition can stop those regeneration dead in its tracks with the Ice Blast.
And wow, Warlock, very nice pick. Now, this is just full on team fight from Tactica Gaming. It's not exactly late game, but a very mid game kind of oriented lineup. Don't you think so, Coach?
Yeah, see, Warlock and Tidehunter are pretty much interchangeable normally, but if you have them stacked together, that's a lot of lockdown, that's a lot of damage going in the way of Tactica Gaming. The ROC, as known in Dota 1, or right now it's Chaotic Offering, actually has a cast range of something like 900 or 1000. That's actually quite a long cast range. You can cast the Chaotic Offering, the Golem, before the team actually has a chance to notice Warlock in certain situations. So with that initiate, followed by a Tidehunter Ravage and Ice Path, that's a lot of lockdown, and that's going to be a lot of damage from the Luna and OD, especially with the OD ult. That's also an
OD
effect. So yeah, they want to catch them all in. If Team Meep Merp wants to take a push, then we'll take on that engagement, says Team Tactica. You go 5 mid, we will kill 5 on mid. So right now, here we go in game. Let's see if Meep Merp can whittle away the towers of Team Tactica before Tactica goes online, or if Tactica can hold on to their defense and keep wiping Team Meep Merp like in the previous game. Now, Ali, I'll leave the introductions to you again.
Yeah, okay, so now, of course, since this is the second game, we're going to see a court swap or a change court, in a manner of speaking. Meep Merp now on the Radiant side, Redman's going to play support once again. He played Leshrac earlier, now it's going for the Shadow Shaman. Raspberry is now playing on the Silencer, Basic on the Lycan, Seb on the Lina, and Kim on the Brewmaster. This is a Brewmaster middle lane. Now we're starting to see a Silencer off lane. I have questions for that, but I'll leave that for coach analysis later. On the Giant team, we have Tactica Gaming, the victors of the first match. We have Togepi on the Tidehunter. We have Nuns on the Jack Hero once again. We have Sen playing OD at the middle lane, Alpha Papa B on the Luna, and Naru on the Warlock. Pretty standard. It seems that both Nuns and Naru are the support players of Tactica Gaming. It seems that Alpha Papa B is their core, it's the position one, while Send is their middle lane. Seems like the positions for Tactica Gaming are now making sense. They're actually settling down on those roles. And now for the laning phase analysis from Coach. Brought to you by Coach.
Okay, so right now it looks like we're going to have a tri lane, but I don't think the Lycan is going to be able to jungle efficiently because of this ward block here. At least until he gets something like a level 3 or level 4. But typically the Lycan wants to get those levels as early as possible so he can take down the larger creep camps solo. But because of these warding, yeah, this is a ward, sentry ward costs 100 gold by itself, but it would easily pay for itself when it blocks off creep camps, especially for a tri-lane. A tri-lane means that those in the tri-lane will have to share experience between the three of them, so each of them will only get a third of the lane experience, and that's a big of a setback in terms of level gain for each of the heroes. While they're going against a Tidehunter, the Tidehunter is naturally tanky. He's probably going to pick up the Kraken Shell when he notices that it's a tri-lane that he's going up against. And if he does so, he's probably going to survive this tri-lane. All he needs to do is just soak up experience until he gets level 6. Maybe if he's lucky, he can farm for a Blink Dagger, but that's not really what he needs. He just needs to survive, get those levels up, and then get to a team fight later on. And now top lane. This is a bit of a more questionable pick, laning. The Silencer is a good pick because it can stop a team fight dead in its tracks. You know, if someone casts an initiate spell like Chaotic Offering, you can cast Silence in response to that, and it prevents the additional stuns from going off. Or if you are in a good position, you can just use it to stop any initiation spells entirely and land your own initiation against the enemy. Right now on bot, we see a bit of harassment. Maybe you dictate this play, Ali. You just dictate
what
is going on right now.
Yeah, well, the bottom lane seems that they're trying to keep Tidehunter at bay. The two supports, the two range supports, actually throwing in the auto attacks, just trying to get the HP down to a very uncomfortable level, which Tidehunter wouldn't want to go so far from the tower. But at the top lane, we see the Jackal actually trying to harass the Silencer. No ice path yet. The Crystal Silencer getting thrown down. Nan's going to lose a lot of HP to this. But the Dire team will now disengage. So it seems that for both teams, they're trying to fulfill their roles and just getting the harassment up and ongoing, rather, continuously whittling down the HP of the enemy solo laners to make sure that they don't have the courage, they don't have the audacity to even cross the river on both lanes.
So let me go on this top lane a bit. The Dire, because there's no creep blocking, they've been able to pull these creep stacks on the pull camp. And if you see now, all three heroes, even though they share EXP divided between the three of them, they're all level 2. While the Silencer is just going to be, he just got his level 2 right now. If you check the...
Hang on. At the top lane, Brewmaster is coming in. Yeah, it's trying to find a kill. That's a double damage. Shadow Shaman TPing in. This Luna is going to get trapped here. How will they react? Double damage just cutting one third of the HP of that Luna. Right off the bat, the first blood going to the Brewmaster with auto attacks, support with a Shackle. And of course, Silencer is going to get 2 intelligence from that kill. I don't know how Brewmaster was able to get into that position, given that they have a ward here, but this Luna actually walked too deep into that lane, and the Shadow Shaman TP was just right on time, and they were able to lock the Luna down.
I don't think they were expecting a rotation from the Brewmaster as early as level 3.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's what got them off guard. Maybe
they
were expecting
that
the Brewmaster would wait until he gets level 4. Before he would take that attempt, but the Brewmaster goes in level 3. I don't care, I have DD. I don't need that level 6 anyway. So right now we see 3 converging on mid. Go on.
So Shadow Shaman is waiting here at the low ground of the ramp here, the middle lane, but he doesn't know that the ward can actually spot him there, and it's daytime, so the vision is actually increased on that ward. Not much vision blocking happening if it's during the daytime, as everyone knows. Now the Lina is trying to wait for a perfect time to get into Sen, just to find the right position to lock him down. But the thing is, Sen already knows what's up. It's trying to bait them to come near him, and well, of course, since the ward is actually giving them the position of the Ranger team, this is going to be a failed gank. It's just wasted time for two supports and a denied experience on that Brewmaster. Now Invirune getting picked up. Brewmaster heading to that to the bottom rune. And the Silencer, wow, it's actually level 3. Well, Luna is sitting at level 3 as well. So if you're going against a Trialing, and the number of last hits that you have is just ridiculously low, and your sort of Silencer, like, who's a very item-dependent hero, you're setting up yourself to for failure.
Yeah, the Silencer has no natural escape. The Silencer is not very tanky, and you know, if they get a good initiate on that Silencer, he's pretty much a goner, especially going up against the Trilane.
Yeah, we see Asher Brewmaster pick up the Invirune, trying to find a kill in the bottom lane, but at the same time, Tidehunter was like busy stacking the Ancients. So he didn't find no kills found there. And now Ancient Apparition. Now the top lane, we see the Jackrio locking down that Silencer with an Ice Pack, and the Shadow Word was used. And they're going to get the kill at the top lane. And this is just so big for the Zarya team. This is going to give them so much space, considering that Luna already has a good farm. And I think he's sitting at 900 gold. I don't know, maybe he's thinking of going for a Midas. What do you think, Coach?
The Luna right now, she can farm uncontested. So maybe she could go for a Midas, but I think I would go against that. I think she should go for something that would increase her team fight capability right now. Maybe a Helm of the Dominator, because they want to start killing people off as early as level 6 for the Tidehunter, level 6 for the Warlock. You know, you're not utilizing your team fight potential to its maximum if you're just going to sit around and farm. Now you can buy your team fight heroes can be used to buy space for your carry to farm. However, right now against a Death Ball lineup, that would be inadvisable. If you're going to allow them to take your team 5 versus 4, they might be able to take towers down, and you know, they might not be able to reach a late game with Luna.
Yeah.
The Luna will and have an advantage late game, of course, but the question is, will they get there? Will Team Meepmerp allow them to get there? If they get their Death Ball up with the Shadow Shaman and the Lycan Wolf's push, maybe they'll have a better chance of shutting down Team Tactica Gaming earlier on.
Yeah, and on that note, Luna is actually, indeed, just as I said, Luna is not going for Midas. She went for the Ring of Aquila. And the ward action coming in hot from the both teams, and the Observer Ward actually gets picked off, and from the Jackrio decides to go for the Sentry Ward, just so you know, just to prevent any detection coming in from the Radiant team. So however, they do lose the Observer Ward, so there's that. And now they're actually farming the Ancient stack. It's 1, 2, 3. It's a 3 stack, I believe, Coach. And it's going to give him a decent amount of farm and level. And just one more Anchor Smash is going to get slowly getting to those skills. And wow, giving him gold from around 200 or 300. It's now sitting at 1,000. Or maybe I just computed it wrong. Anyway, at the top lane, Luna is doing well against the Silencer. Silencer has the level 6. He's actually ahead of levels compared to Lina, who's just sitting at level 5. And I think this Lina is the supports for Lina need to come back to that lane. And now Primal Speed coming in from the Brewmaster, Ice Bath from Nons, locking down the two Brewlings. Will they be able to find a kill here? This Brewmaster is so alone, has the two supports coming in. They were able to find stun table on Nons. Chainstone coming in, the Ravage coming in from Togepi coming in hot, and now the Lycan has the goes for the Metamorphosis, chasing the Togepi down. This might actually be two kills for the Raiden team. Silence coming in from the Silencer, of course, trying to give the Zarya team additional support to find a kill. Now Shackles coming in from the Shadow Shaman, Obsidian Destroyer with auto attacks there. They're going to find a kill in the Shadow Shaman. OD has the gold for that. Lina dies to the Dire team, and now they're chasing down the Lycan. No metamorphosis left. It's just literally walking slowly. And wow, they actually owed it to Leviathan, who was blocking the way. I don't know why he did that. Anyway, they're just trying to chase this one down, and actually they might
have the Astral.
They might find a kill. Yeah, the Ice Buff coming in to ensure the lockdown. Liquid Fire and everything is up on everybody. Auto attacks, and the Ultra Devourer finds a kill on that. And by the way, Ultra Devourer actually reserved the skill points for the Arcane Orb for later. Arcane Orb is still not less skilled up. Which kind of makes sense, actually. So yeah, there's that, Coach.
Now we have a 2,000 gold lead for Team Tactica and a 4,000 EXP advantage. Now this is not going to look good for Team Meepmerp. Meepmerp wants to have that early game in the form of ganking, in the form of pushing down towers with Shadow Shaman and Lycan. But, you know, if they're losing this much earlier on, and they're giving Luna free reign, the Luna just might be able to overtake that early game advantage that the Lycan should have. The Lycan actually was ahead a while ago in net worth, was number one, but now number one in net worth because of that engagement and a few kills going his way.
Mm-hmm.
He's now ahead in net worth with 4,600 gold to his name.
And the Radiant now going for the push. The Radiant team, Meepmerp, seems to be really inclined to choosing any kind of Deathmall strat. And now they're trying to push the middle lane. Yeah, they have the Howl. They don't have the wards yet, but they do have the damage to all attackers' tower. To Oblivion, Primal Strip is not yet, is indeed in cooldown for the Brewmaster. But I think they're just going to disengage. At the top lane, we see the Silencer. We see the Dire team ganging up the Silencer. Will we be able to get the Ice Path in? Good job there, Nons. Now the Shadow Ward might be thrown. Silence coming in wasted, actually, to defend himself. Now Shadow Ward coming in from the Warlock, giving enough HP and regeneration on the Luna. Ice Path defensive from Nons coming in to lock this Brewmaster down. Brewmaster just gonna chase the Luna down anyway. The Cliffs was actually thrown down by the Luna. Gets two hits on top of that Brewmaster, and now it's 2-0 in favor of the Dire team. Shackles coming in from Redman. He does find their Warlock, but not before Warlock drops the Golem, and this might actually be a push on the top tier 1 tower. Wow. Very, very well played there. Nice command of skills. And TP coming in from the Radiant team, it's going to be that Silencer. He is actually around 850 gold away, 850 gold shy of that mechanism. So I guess at the very least he gets a little bit of farm after all the things that has been happening.
Let's check out the gold graph again. Right now, a while ago, the graph went a bit up towards the Radiant. But it's now gone back down to almost 3,000 in favor of Team Tactica. And the EXP graph just keeps snowballing down. 7,500 EXP in favor of Tactica. This is because Tactica is able to spread their people out. They don't really need all 5 heroes in one lane to do something. They have more lanes to farm. And of course, they get that sweet, sweet EXP from those kills and ancient stacks.
Mm-hmm.
Right now, I think there's a push going on top.
Yeah, the top lane. I think that team will be just giving this one away. I don't see any TP coming in. And they're going to go for an exchange, Coach. I think they're just pressing forward at the bottom lane. It's going to be the top lane, the top tower, top tier 1 tower of the Dire for the top tier, for the bottom tier 1 tower of the Radiant team. And I think it will be worth it, definitely, because, well, for one, it's not like the Dire team is pressured to push, right? So any kind of tower exchange is actually kind of optional for them. They just want the kills. They just want to survive until the Luna gets a farm. And the Boulder Smash actually hits the Luna. Defensive Ice Path coming from Nons. No Macro Fire there. Global Silence from the Silencer. Metamorphosis on this Lycan. Tidehunter blinking out. It's not going to find any kills. It's really hard. Finding it hard to not find those kills. No lockdowns coming in from his teammates. The Global Silence actually wasted, and now there is no way for them to force a push on this tower because the Ravage is still on cooldown. It's not yet, but now it is. This is Tyrant, we can now blink in any time now. Now throws that ultimate OD close to Sadik, his Eclipse and Fire Shadow Shaman double kill. Relina falling second to the hands of the OD and Jacquero killing the Brewmaster with a Liquid Fire.
This is not
and now,
good.
This is not looking good for Leap Merp. It might, we're now, it's too early to say, but it might be a 2-0 for Tactica Gaming. Tactica Gaming really knows how to read, how to engage, and you know, calculate what does the enemy have, what do they have, and within the things that they have, can we actually fight? So these questions, I think Tactica Gaming has figured out. And when you actually notice how they play, they know the limits of their HP. I think I mentioned this before, Coach. They're actually one of the teams who can actually compute how exactly deep into a tower dive they can go.
Can you check the EXP per minute for the heroes? The bottom four are all from Meat Merp. Look at this, the Shadow Shaman has less than 100 EXP per minute. The Shadow Shaman is still at level 5, actually still has no ultimate at 15 minutes in the game! 15 minutes
and
in the game, no,
actually,
no ultimate!
Actually, we did notice that, considering how many things have been happening, it's just a lot. I mean, you'd expect that something has been happening for the Ragion team, but this is just Tactica Gaming playing their best.
Yeah, I would really have to say right now, pardon me if this is bias coming out, but yeah, this is just a complete outplay of Tactica Gaming over Team Meat Merp. A while ago, it might have looked a bit more even, but Team Meat Merp right now is looking too stubborn. They're still going with that Death Ball strat, and Tactica Gaming has an even better Death Ball counter than the previous game.
Naru goes online with an Agony Scepter on his Warlock, wow, it's a complete Death Ball. And yeah, actually, don't worry, it's not exactly biased. It's big. When you look, even if you look at it from an objective point of view, you have to say that the Meat Merp team is getting outplayed so much.
I think they know Roshan is going. They're a bit too late to the party.
Yeah, they were actually hesitating to engage because even though the wolves were there, the wolves were scouting, they didn't have the Brewmaster in position, I believe. And the Brewmaster actually, Coach, if you look at the Brewmaster, he doesn't have anything on him. Maybe the Blink Dagger is coming in. Yes, the Blink Dagger is coming into the Brewmaster. And this might actually give him some sort of initiation capabilities. Oh, Ice Path getting thrown there on the Illusion Rune. Although that won't matter much. That's around like a few seconds of cooldown. Okay, 9 seconds, not really that much. And now they're gonna push the tier 1 tower here. How will the Meat Merp team survive? They don't have the ward drop, by the way. And wow, the Ravage coming in from Togepi with a Warlock follow-up. Now Shadow Shaman definitely going down. And the Silence getting thrown down by the Silencer, but not before all the ultimates have been casted. Now it's just too late for that Global Silence. It's going to be a wasted Global Silence, mainly because all the ultimates and the skills have been casted already. There's nothing silence. Everything is on cooldown, and the Luna pops the Aegis, and now this is definitely going to be a push. Warlock is just hacking away the tower with his skull, and Brewmaster dies as well. He was actually able to use the Primal Split, but not as you have seen, as you have noticed, not much effect on that team fight right there from the Primal Split.
Alright, you should really check the EXP per minute right now.
Yeah, right I'm now, looking. It's the first 5 positions are for the Dire team.
Yeah, even their lowest EXP guy, the Warlock. The Warlock has a higher level than the highest level of Team Meat Merp. And right now they're going for a tower push. They know they can take this.
Yeah, they know that the Primal Split is on cooldown. There's no Global Silence. Global Silence, given that, you know, it's a common knowledge that Global Silence takes so much time to cool down. They really have enough time to take the rats and just keep harassing and maybe pick up some more kills if they wanted to. Now, Astral Imprisonment on top of the Silencer. Icebath coming and locking down the Lina, and Odie's just hacking away at him. Tidehunter does die, however, but now the Brewmaster is just helpless, so helpless during those own attacks, and wow, this is pushing the Radiant team back to their fountains on their own base, inside their own base. Odi finds another kill, goes for a double kill on top of the Shadow Shaman. I hear another Astral Imprisonment somewhere. I think it's on top of himself. Brewmaster, actually, did he buy back? Did the Brewmaster buy back? Or did he just respawn? Oh, no, status. He didn't die. He actually just TP'd in front of the base and blinked in to find a kill on that OD. So he did actually gain a monster kill streak, giving him, like, what? A total of 800 gold, more or less. But not before the melee barracks were taken down. So now it's just a big hole right smack in the middle of the Radiant team, when they actually don't have the levels yet to pick themselves up from this rubble.
The Shadow Shaman, 20 minutes into the game,
still in level 5.
Still has no Serpent Wards. This is really, really terrible for Team Meat Merp.
And wow, I don't know. How do you think they would be able to pick themselves up from here, Coach?
I'm not sure. They really need that Serpent Wards up. I don't know why they're not giving EXP to Shadow Shaman. They're overlooking the fact that just because he's a carry, they think that they can not prioritize him in terms of EXP and gold. But Shadow Shaman, something's happening on top. The Warlock.
Yeah, trying to take the Warlock off, but Shadow Word is casted. Again, Global Science being wasted just to get a kill on a Warlock that would not die. Now, a Warlock's on the Agonist Golem, two golems actually spawning on that ultimate. The Outdoor Devourer finds a kill on the Shadow Shaman first and then just kills the Shadow the Silencer a few seconds right after. And now Lina actually is trying to defend, trying to go for the Harass. Togepi blinks in. He wants to get that Gush in. He didn't want to find the Gush in, but yeah, now he finds it. Anchor Smash first was gonna throw the Gush. Lina misses her stun. This Togepi have to go back. And now he actually blinks away to the safety of his teammates. Now, more stuff coming in from Sen. He does actually imprison somebody. I don't know who. They find the kill on Lina. Luna actually with Eclipse finds a double kill. Within a second push, within a second, he finds the kill on the level 5 Shadow Shaman and on the level 7 Lina. Really under level right there.
You know what the shame was?
What?
The Shadow Shaman is literally one creep away from getting his level 6.
Oh no, that is just so sad. Rabbit still on foot, an Anchor Smash on top of this. Silencer is gonna die to the auto attack. OD with that Arcane Orb, wow, just doing a good job at being a, position 1? Can he say it's position 1? I'm not really sure. Shackles coming in from the Shadow Shaman, locking the Luna down, but no, he gets taken down with HP again. Everybody from the Raiden team is dying within a second of each other, more or less. Ashton Imprisonment to save his teammate right there. Now, the Primal Sweep might actually be wasted. Luna just auto-attacking everyone here. BKB up on Sen. Lina dies once again to the Warlock. Just constantly dying. We're now looking at a 425 in favor of the Dire Team. Blink.
And the GG is called.
Blink out from the Brewmaster, and the GG is called. It was 2-0. Tactica versus Meeper dies. You can see that it was a very well played game. And we see a friendly advice coming in from Naru saying that you have to chill. For those who can beat that. Yeah, he's actually saying to the other team, chill down. Because, it might actually be a trash track. I don't know what's going down. Coach, can you manage the teams? Anyway, for those of you watching, it is Tactica Gaming taking away the best of three for this second match in the official start of the prize giveaways in the Selimeri Dora. Whew! Wow, and we will be seeing another game tomorrow. We will keep you guys posted about the schedule and who are the teams who will be playing. And yeah, we're just waiting for the game to finish, Coach. What do you think? Are they canceling the Digicall? Isn't it that when you type GG, something will show up and then you're gonna cancel it?
Yeah, it should, but
I guess the Radiant team is canceling. Yeah, maybe they're canceling it.
Yeah, maybe they just really want to see this Ancient Fall.
Yeah, and well, okay, another GG call, so it's 10 seconds, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. It should pop by now. Yep, it did. Okay, so guys, we'll be wrapping up and moving on to the rewards ceremony for Tactica Gaming, in which we'll be giving them 4 choices of chests, 1 for each player, for winning the best of 3. Thank you guys so much, and I'll see you guys in a few minutes. Coach, can you play this? Can you talk to the stream and play them some music while I coordinate with Tactica Gaming for their prizes?
All right.
Okay. So, okay, I'm going to share it now. Hey, I almost forgot. I almost clicked on that. And I'm going to share the screen, and then, yes, I'm going to share my screen. Coach, can you see it?
In Skype? Oh, here we go. So...
Oh, can you see the offerings?
Yeah, here's my display. I'm showing it live to stream right now. So...
Okay, so again, the winners of tonight's match is Tactica Gaming. They went against Meatmurf and they actually wiped them with a 2-0, with a score of 2-0. It's a quite amazing, it's quite an amazing feat. Now, I'm going to give the requesters that they wanted 5 trope characters, and we're gonna give it to them. Right? We're gonna give it to them just now. Okay, I'm just gonna click on the trade, and they're actually waiting for the trade to be established. And I'm going to click the make trade now in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Come on, Valve, don't disappoint me. And the trade has been completed. Congratulations, yay! Congratulations, Tactica Gaming, for making, for winning the game tonight. And it's actually what we want, right? We encouraged the game to finish like in a best of 3, to be finished in 2 games. Not because we're lazy or anything, but because it kind of allows us to stack more games each evening, right, Coach?
So yeah, we want as much teams as possible to sign up. You win something, you get to help us in making matches every night, and everybody wins. Come on.
Yeah, everyone wins. So now, because of that, we have to tell you guys that unfortunately this is the end of today's cast. This has been Nightly Dota with me, Salimene, and of course the beloved Coach Dota. And this actually ends our broadcast stream. We will see you tomorrow, and we'll update you during the afternoon for the matches for tomorrow. And yeah, please guys, sign up and invite your friends. Tell them that, hey, there's a legit community coming in. Please join us, because we love your faces, as XXE would say in the YouTube, in his YouTube channel. Sorry, I just ran to the mansion. This is where I got the phrase from. Anyway, Coach, please play them a stream. Please play them some music so that they could ease into the sleep cycle after a very, very good night of games. Thank you so much, guys, and we'll see you guys tomorrow. Bye.